With our prolonged spring, you may have noticed an abundance of flowers growing in your garden or around your neighborhood, and along with the flowers come the bees. We wanted to find out more about the bees you can find hovering around your flowers, so we reached out to Utah Department of Agriculture and Food to find out more about our little worker friends. Stephen, thanks so much for joining us here. We're in this beautiful home garden in Holiday. So what kind of bees might homeowners see in their gardens around their flower beds?
For the casual observer, I would break it down as honeybees, which everybody should be familiar with. It's our state symbol, right? Bumblebees, carpenter bees, as well as an assortment of native bees.
Okay.
The bumblebees and carpenter bees are going to be the big bombastic bees that you hear and you duck as they come by. And the native bees are oftentimes going to be smaller and a little bit more understated.
How many species does Utah have, do you know?
So Utah has over 1,200 species of native bees, which is phenomenal. In fact, the southern half of Utah has as many native species as the entire eastern half of North America.
Wow.
So Utah really is a haven for bee biodiversity.
That's so cool. I had no idea. Should we go into the garden and see if we can find some?
Yeah, let's do it.
All right, so we're out here by the raspberry bushes. There's one right there.
You see that little kind of glob there?
Yeah.
That's pollen that she's collected.
Okay.
And so they have stiff hairs on their hind legs that they actually pack the pollen onto, and they pull that back to the hive. So if you look at the hive entrance, you'll actually see a lot of bees coming back with brightly colored hind legs, and that's pollen being brought back to the hive.
What are the best practices for a homeowner to do to help support bees?
In order for homeowners to help, it does help for them to understand the stressors that bees are under, and they're often referred to as the four Ps, so parasites, pathogens, poor nutrition, and pesticides. For pathogens and parasites, that's not really something that the average homeowner can help with, but with poor nutrition and pesticides, that's an area where they really can make a difference. For poor nutrition, obviously planting flowering plants, planting native plants helps a lot, as well as planting fruits and vegetables.
Mm-hmm.
And then for pesticides, really responsible pesticide use is gonna make a big difference. The biggest thing that people can do is actually to read and follow the label on pesticide products that they use.
Okay.
You'd be surprised how big of a difference it would make if we could just get people to read the label and follow the instructions. And the label is the law. You are required to follow the instructions on the package.
Okay.
If people can avoid applying pesticides to flowers in bloom, and if they need to apply pesticide to a plant that's blooming, if they can wait till evening when most of the bees are going to be home. And by waiting until evening, that gives the entire night for the pesticide to absorb and for the residual toxicity to go down.
Can you talk a little bit about pollination?
Yeah, so flowers provide almost the entirety of bee diets, and they're interested in the nectar for their carbohydrates and the pollen for the protein. Many fruits, nuts, and vegetables, for instance, need to be cross-pollinated in order to set a fruit.
Okay.
So some bees are better at pollinating one type of flower versus another type. So for example, tomatoes are best pollinated by bumblebees, who are able to buzz-pollinate the flowers because the pollen is held tight in the stamens, and so the bee needs to hang on to the flower and shake its wings so that it can loosen that pollen.
How do you attract all types of bees to your garden, these healthy pollinators, native and solitary bees?
So if you can, plant native plants. Native flowering plants are definitely going to be best for both honeybees and for the native bees in particular. One great plant that actually isn't a native plant, but is a great plant, easy to take care of, is Russian sage. It's got a lot of blooms. It blooms for a very long time, and it's actually a pretty pleasant plant to have in your yard.
Nice. How can gardeners identify the different types of bees in their gardens?
So the first thing to do as far as identifying bees is identifying what's not a bee. Flies can be really close mimics until you see them land. A good way to identify the flies is that flies only have two wings, whereas all bees are going to have four. The next thing to distinguish would be between bees and wasps. A good way to tell bees and wasps apart: wasps are going to be relatively smooth and hairless.
Okay.
And wasp hairs, if you look at wasp hairs, a lot of them are going to be shiny and reflective, whereas all bee hairs are going to be very dull and flat and won't shimmer from any angle.
So as far as safety goes, you know, you're a homeowner, you have kids around, a lot of people are afraid of bees. What kind of ways can we be safe around bees?
So most bees just want to be left alone. They've got very little interest in you, and they are not out to sting anybody. In fact, the sting is there just as a deterrent to say, I want to be left alone. And the biggest way or the most common way that people tend to get stung is when bees get trapped in clothing,
mm-hmm.
and in people's hair.
Mm-hmm.
That tends to happen. But avoiding overly fragrant perfumes definitely helps, because that can kind of confuse the bee.
Oh.
They're coming around to see you. They say, oh, this person smells like a blooming flower.
Oh, wow.
Most bees are
harmless.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. All right, everyone. Thanks so much for watching. Follow us on Instagram, like us on Facebook, and subscribe to our YouTube channel for more awesome information about gardening.